Welcome to All About Hopkinton, the HCAM original program highlighting the people and organizations that make Hopkinton a great place to live. I'm Mary Arnott, your host. Today we have with us Hopkinton resident and musician Steve Spector. Welcome, Steve.
Thanks, Mary. Thanks for having me.
Well, I'm really glad you could be on the show because you and I work together as volunteers at HCAM on the sports and things, and so it's nice to be able to just sit down and talk to you about all the other areas that you're involved
Perfect.
In.
Perfect. Yeah, we've had some good times at the Hopkinton High basketball games, and you do a great job on the camera and keeping me in check there. But we've had some good games there. So, yeah.
Now you consider Hopkinton your hometown. You've been here quite a few years. And in fact, as I recall, you work for a Hopkinton company, Select?
Yes, yeah, so my wife Dawn and I moved here in 1996. We built a house on Huckleberry Road, so we've had a really good run there. It's been a really good time raising our family, Michael and Olivia, our kids. And for the last few years, I've been working for Hopkinton company Select Energy, and it's a commercial solar company. I do business development for them. It's got a hometown feel. There's a lot of the leadership are gentlemen from town, and we've raised our families together, so it's been it's good to be part of that company.
Yeah, I know a little bit about it because I actually did a show once and ran a camera for them when they were at one of their big customers.
Sure.
And I was talking about it, so
great.
I'm familiar with the but the big story here that I'd really like to talk about, well, there's a number of things because you're involved in a lot of things, but I'd really like to get into, many people in our audience might know you from your band and your music, and you've been, you know, doing concerts and things and lots of venues and gigs, so we're going to talk about your music.
Sure.
So.
Absolutely. Well, let's see. I don't know where to start because
it's
been 20 years. It's been sort of a flow. So what I'll say right up front is one of the best parts about the music is it's been a sort of a, it's generated a lot of joy for people in town, sharing the music and drawing people together at some of my gigs. And some of them have been at the schools. Some of them have been at the local venues like Fireflies and Marlboro for the last several years. My band Hot Acoustics has played there. And several Hopkinton residents and friends and colleagues and things have joined us at those gigs. And in regards to the local connection musically, a big highlight for me was last year playing at the Hopkinton 300th anniversary celebration, which there was about 8,000 or 10,000 people there. It felt like tens of thousands of people there, but we were fortunate to be invited to be the headliner of that event, and they had the fireworks. We played before and after the fireworks, so that was very exciting. And so those are a couple of things. When my kids were real small, I used to bring my acoustic guitar into center school in their kindergarten and first grade classes and play the theme from Barney and various, just engage with the kids and little circle time. And some of the little kids, as I recall, would request like Led Zeppelin tunes and stuff like that. So it was, going from that point and fast forwarding lots of gigs. I was invited to play in the Hooray for Hollywood play for the Cultural Arts Alliance back in, I want to say, 2003. And they gave me an Elvis Presley sort of part, playing a couple songs with electric guitar, and it was a wonderful community event. So to be involved with that musically was a lot of fun as well. But those are a couple things that I've had over the years, musically.
You must know a lot of different songs and everything if you can play for little kids and then Led Zeppelin, and your music is wide repertoire there, right? You just
part of it, like any organization or any team, you're as good as the people you surround yourself with. So I've been fortunate over the years to have connected with a network of musicians in Metro West who are just super talented. So I've kind of evolved musically as a result of connecting to that network, and they were a lot of the guys and ladies, mostly the gentlemen, but they were a little older than me. So when I got out of college, UMass Amherst, it was 1984. I think one of my first gigs was at Cornell's back in the day, and the North Pond House, which is not now, no longer there. But again, I connected with some older guys who were really talented, and kind of brought me along and sort of mentored me. And that was really helpful. And then it's just been an evolution over the years. And it's been a lot of, as I said earlier, joy to be playing everything from 70s, 80s, 90s, Clapton, Allman Brothers, Steely Dan, Pink Floyd, The Who, Tom Petty, Beatles, Stones, and then James Taylor, Jim Croce, and then most recently more some John Mayer, current stuff. So we kind of covered the gamut, and it's been a really nice thing to have in my life, and in addition to my professional career, to have this sort of musical space as well, mm-hmm. and sharing with everybody.
Well, how did you get into music? I mean, what was the thing that just catapulted you into this?
Boy,
great talent you have.
That's nice. I guess a few influences in my life. First of all, my mom was a piano player, so we always had a piano in the house. And she played everything, kind of comical, but everything. She had a certain style. She played everything sort of like a cha-cha. Hmm. But that's a little of her style. But we always had sing-alongs, and "Leave It on a Jet Plane" was one of the songs I remember singing.
Yes.
The family gatherings and things like that. But I guess when I was about 13 or 14 years old, my older sister, Margie, started dating a gentleman, Steve, in Framingham North and South, this cross-town relationship, and they eventually got married. But Steve was a very talented guitar player. And he taught me how to play a few songs growing up, one of which was Behind Blue Eyes by The Who, which I still play today. Mm. So Steve Anderson, my brother-in-law, was the biggest influence musically growing up as I was kind of in my teenage years. But I certainly was sort of a late bloomer as compared to the people I play with today. It took me until I got into college to kind of get my legs under me, and when I got to UMass Amherst, I started playing a lot of acoustic type shows and learning some songs like from the Grateful Dead and Crosby, Stills, Nash, Eagles. Kind of got my vocals moving a little bit, and anyway, so from there it kind of launched and got through college, and then connected with some of the musicians around here. So that's kind of how it worked out, mm-hmm. largely.
Well. UMass Amherst, great school. It's where my son graduated from also. Little connection there.
There you go. No, that's a great, Amherst is a great town, and yeah. Northampton's down the street, and certainly a great place to sort of launch into the music scene. Mm-hmm.
But in addition to playing guitar and piano, you're also a songwriter and singer, obviously. Is there anything you want to tell us about some of the songwriting that you've done?
Well, let's see. I wrote a bunch of songs in college. Mm-hmm. I wish I recorded them more than I have over the years. So that's something that I still have time to do. I have touched upon some songs that I recorded years ago. They sat dormant for a while as things were evolving, and then like having kids and getting married and things like that. And I've revisited a lot of those songs, some of which I played on the guitar and then revisited on the piano later on, which has been really fun and interesting. So I still aspire to maybe do a little bit more recording of my original songs. I have about 15 original songs. Some of them have been played in the radio back in the late 80s, 90s, early 90s. I had an interesting connection with a movie in the year 2000. It was came out of a sad situation. Travis Roy, the hockey player from Boston University, first year playing for BU, and had just a terrible accident 11 seconds into his first collegiate game.
Yeah.
And I think we talked about that story.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a movie that was going to be coming out for Travis called 11 Seconds. And a lot of people were involved. Matt Damon was going to play Travis. Annette Bening was going to play his mom. And on the soundtrack, Neil Young was going to be on it, and Natalie Merchant, and somehow I got connected to an attorney who was involved with the project. And I lived in Framingham at the time where I grew up, and I lived in Westboro at the time. But we actually lived in Hoppington at the time. Maybe we can fix that up. But what happened was we did this, we made this connection with Travis through this attorney, and I wrote a song called Heart of a Champion, and that was gonna be the theme of the movie. Unfortunately, the movie didn't pan out, but as a result of that experience, we did a fundraiser in town that was a benefit for Travis. And another Hoppington resident, Chad Shepard, said, had an unfortunate spinal cord injury at a similar time. So we did this dual fundraiser for Chad and Travis at Cornell's Field back in 2000. And it was a pretty big event. We had hundreds of people there in the field, and my band played and raised a bunch of money for both of them and their foundations and things like that. But introducing Chad to Travis at that time was quite memorable and big highlight, I guess, you know, under the circumstances. So I still aspire to spend more time, if I can find some time, to work mm-hmm. on my originals and cultivate them and record them a little more. So that's on my bucket list, I guess you could say.
Yeah, well, that was a very good thing, doing that theme song and bringing them together like that. What was that like when they met? Do you remember? Because I know it was quite a few years ago.
Well, they were both in wheelchairs, and it was sort of an anticipation, you know, coming together. And I think they were both a little nervous, but they both learned a lot from each other, mm-hmm. as I recall. I know Chad at the time had a girlfriend. They were both around 19 or 20 years old, and obviously, there's no good age to have something like that happen. But mm-hmm. Travis didn't have a girlfriend, but sort of aspired to. And Chad had a girlfriend, so they talked a little bit about that. It was just a quite humbling experience, and you know, my kids got to meet them, and you know, teaching moment, and certainly having that connection at that level when there's a lot of people around. And again, as I said earlier, the music was the sort of driving force to bring a lot of people together for a really good cause, and mm-hmm. and we still look for opportunities to do that now. So I will say, similarly, on a more of an annual basis, I have been invited to play, my band, I should say, Hot Acoustics, mm-hmm. plays quite a bit. Well, every year for, I want to say, the last 8 or 9 years now, for the Sharon Timlin Road Race. So that's Abby Rosenberg and Dave Kruger and a bunch of folks have done an incredible job, raised well over $1 million for ALS research. So every year, I think this year is June 17th, behind the middle school, we'll be playing there from about, you know, 9 to 12 or whatever, after the 1,800 runners finish their 5K race. The good news is I don't have to do the race. I get to play music. So, that's a really very fortunate to be able to do that every year. That's a really great gig.
It seems like your music and your talents have had some real side benefits of connecting with people, really putting you out there and making those connections with people in different organizations. And when you volunteer to...
Yeah. Well, I guess that's been a benefit of that. And again, as we're talking, I'm thinking about some of the other opportunities that have come my way and my family's way as a result of music. One of them comes to mind was about, I want to say, 4 years ago, when I have some friends at Hoppington, and obviously that's what we're here for. It's all about Hoppington. But yeah. But mm-hmm. I have, growing up in Framingham, a lot of my high school friends have sort of dispersed in some of the surrounding towns, and I have a bunch of friends in Ashland. So I was asked when Ashland finished their big high school football field, they have a new turf field there, and I want to say it was 4 years ago now, they asked me to be the halftime show on the Thanksgiving Day game with Ashland and Hoppington. And I was flattered by that. I wasn't quite sure what they wanted me to do. A lot of my music is sort of acoustic based, and I asked if they wanted the whole band, because mm-hmm. there's probably a couple thousand people there, whatever it was, which that's what it was. And they said, no, just like an acoustic type of thing. So I'm trying to think of what to do. So At the time, my daughter was, a freshman at UMass Amherst, but just graduated, and my daughter Olivia, and then my son Michael was still at high school, at Hopkinton High School. So I kind of suggested that maybe with the three of us could do a halftime show because it's a high school event, and that worked out great. So as a result of my musical connections around, you know, over the years, to be invited to that event, and then at halftime we went out and we played a few songs. One of them was Midnight Rider by the Allman Brothers. So it was just myself with my acoustic guitar, Michael and Olivia, and the first half of the football game ended, and then we had already done, you know, done the trial run before the game early in the morning on Thanksgiving Day, and we got four or five guys. They were big husky guys because they moved the PA system in 5 minutes, and then we moved out to midfield, and then we played Midnight Rider by the Allman Brothers, and we did the three-part harmony, which was really cool. Let's see, another song I don't remember that my son Michael sang, and then we did Home by Philip Phillips, and we dedicated that song. This is hard for me because it's all about Hopkinton, but yeah. You know, for the new home field for Ashland. So, but I must say, when we got there early, the Hopkinton High football team was there, and I had a sweatshirt on that for, it was neutral, it was just dark, but underneath it I had a Hopkinton High shirt underneath it. So I shared that with the football team before the game, and they were like, give me the thumbs up, so that was pretty cool. But, you know, music, to have your own children, and, you know, the family gatherings are always pretty high-level sing-alongs with harmonies and things like that, and so I'm grateful for that. So, you know, the connection to the community here, there was a really great venue in Maynard, Mass, called the Sitting Bull Pub, and people like Bonnie Raitt and Joe Cocker over the years used to perform there, and it was a go-to place, and then some of the laws for the sprinkler systems changed, and they had to close it down, but we had some unbelievable gigs at the Sitting Bull Pub, and it was a wonderful venue, and we had 100 to 150 people going there, you know, to see us all the time, and this is probably the early 2000s. It was tons of Hopkinton people making the drive, and I'll always be grateful for that. So it's just sort of generated, music has a lot of wonderful friendships that are really strong for myself and my family. So,
well, I wanted to ask you, since you mentioned that you had that wonderful occasion to do the halftime show at the Ashland football game, and you had Olivia and Michael there, do they sing and play instruments as well?
So they both, yes, they both play guitar, and Olivia is, she now works at TJX, sort of in the allocation analyst, has a really nice job coming out of UMass Amherst. But she's always been a singer. She has the most powerful voice in the family, no question about it, and beautiful pitch. My son Michael, who's a sophomore at UMass Amherst, is in a really high-level a cappella singing group, and they were on WGBH-TV last year, and there was some competition, and they're really humble, but they ended up winning the college division. And he's become a singer-songwriter, and sort of launching into that area, both personally and sort of his major at college. So yeah, we all sing. Even my wife Donna sings really beautifully. She doesn't like to perform live in front of folks. Mm-hmm. We sometimes can encourage her to do that. But it's been great having the music connection with my children has been pretty special.
So that wonderful music talent runs throughout the whole family.
we've gotten some of that feedback, which is, you know, we're very fortunate. You know, we've worked hard. We all have. Doesn't just like any. It's like anything. It could be, you know, I have friends who are good golfers, for example. They you know, or artists or whatever you focus on. I've always been into sports. And at some point in time, you can't do all the things you used to do in your 20s or 30s or even 40s, But what I find is music has continues to evolve for me at this point in my life, and I'm grateful for that. And then just it continues to lead to wonderful relationships and friendships. And you know, I think it's going to continue.
Yep. Well, let's talk a little bit about that sports side, because I know you like to do the basketball games at the high school for the varsity when HCAM is there, and you're helping with being a commentator and announcer. And tell us a little bit about the sports background, what you've done in the area of sports and coaching.
Well, sure, this is kind of an interrogation here, Mary.
just whatever you want to share.
No, that's fine. I'm just kidding. Let's see. Growing up, I was always into sports, so. Mm-hmm. We played street hockey in Framingham growing up, and the big bad Bruins were really prominent with Bobby Orr, Derek Sanderson those days. So some of the folks will remember those days. Always played basketball. Went to overnight camp. It was sports camp, so basketball, soccer, just whatever, even water skiing and things like that. So,
tell us about that little George Wheeler connection you have with Framingham. Okay. That has to do with sports, right?
It does. Thank you for bringing that up. So, sixth, seventh, and eighth grade, my gym teacher is a gentleman named George Wheeler. He was actually my first grade gym teacher. I seem to have Mr. Wheeler almost every year through eighth grade as my gym teacher, as Framingham changed and grew. Mm-hmm. And as an eighth grader, he said, "Hey, Steve, you should go out for soccer next year." I said, "Why, Mr. Wheeler, would I want to do that? I play basketball and soccer. I'm sorry, basketball and hockey, but I don't really play soccer." He said, "Well, you would be a pretty good goalie." And I said, "Okay." And he said, "By the way, I'm the varsity coach." I said, "Well, okay. Well, maybe that. Thank you for the heads up." So freshman year at Framingham North, I was kind of a skinny 14-year-old or whatever, 13-year-old, and played in the freshman team, and then my sophomore year, the senior goalie blew his knee out or something, and I was the only available goalie for a pretty big team. Framingham was pretty big. So then I played for Mr. Wheeler for 3 years. And then, unfortunately, you know, fast forward a little bit, 1994, Mr. Wheeler, I refer to Mr. Wheeler because he's my first grade gym teacher,
Coach Wheeler.
Was an incredible, if you can think of your most favorite teacher and coach, he was both, you know, very witty, always got the most out of his students and players, and it didn't matter if you were an all-star or if you were just sort of a below average athlete, he always made you feel really good. So another Hoppington resident, I have created the George Wheeler Cup. Lou Papadelis and a teacher at Framingham North, Denise Gallagher, friend of Coach Wheeler. The three of us, over 20 years ago, we started the George Wheeler Cup, and it's in memory of him, and it started out as an alumni game between Framingham alumni, Framingham North, Framingham South. It eventually evolved into a alumni game first, and then a varsity game, boys, Framingham versus Natick. And my friend Lou Papadelis at the time he's an outstanding soccer player, but he was coaching the Natick High boys team. So at Bowditch Field in Framingham, Mr. Wheeler, sadly I should say, in 1994 passed away from lymphoma. And he had just took the girls team to the state championship game. Mm-hmm. And it was pretty inspiring as he passed. But anyway, so many of us were moved by him and had the pleasure and honor to play for him. Lou and I started this event, and 20 years later, it became a you know, probably the biggest regular season soccer event in the state annually. So at Bowditch Field every year, we'd have about 1,000 people in the stands, raise money for scholarships, and the alumni game, the event evolved. Eventually, the alumni game portion kind of fizzled out, but what we did was we replaced it with a U14 girls game, a U14 boys game. So these are the eighth graders primarily feeding the varsity teams, and then there would be a girls varsity game and a boys varsity game. So sort of a soccer jamboree, and you know, I'll always be forever grateful for Mr. Wheeler, because he pulled me into a direction I would have never even played soccer, and then I became a pretty decent goalie and played for him for a few years. And I was supposed to play at UMass Amherst. I had like a lot of us old-time weekend warriors. I've torn my ACL a couple times, and I never really played in college, which I regret, but I played later as an adult in town here with a bunch of, you know, not enough time to get into some of the names of the, but some wonderful mm-hmm. friends I've made from playing soccer, you know, adult league soccer in town. And so that's kind of how the George Wheeler Cup evolved, and it continues today. Lou and I just passed the torch to Framingham United Soccer, and they're running it now. And we've raised a whole bunch of money, and we give out annual scholarships, which we're very proud of that too. So,
well, very dedicated 20 years doing that, and I'm sure it will continue under the new organization.
Yeah, and we're still in touch with them, but we. Yeah. So that was a something I'm very proud of, and Lou and my friend Lou as well.
Well, through all of this, what comes through is that you're a real people person. I really appreciate you being on the show today.
Thanks, Mary. It's been great.
If you'd like more information about Steve and his music, visit his Facebook page located on the screen below. For everyone here at HCAM, I'm Mary Arnott, and thank you for watching this episode of All About Hopkinton.
This show often talks to people who have interesting hobbies or careers or different things that they have going on that affect our community.
I'm Mary Arnott, your host.
There is a huge need for providing food for individuals and family.
And that's the key.
It's the key.
It's working well together.
You can see more episodes online at our website, hcam.tv.
The Hopkinton Coffee Break.
A very special dessert done by a woman from Hopkinton that I've started using regularly.
We had your residents participating both as vendors and as shoppers, and
that was so much fun!
Real Hopkinton Housewives, if you're on Facebook, you will have a blast. Thanks for joining
us. Cheers, guys.
Had a great,
thank you.
Yeah, good to see you
too. Guys.